I introduce Dr. Alessandro Breccia. Alessandro Breccia gained his PhD in History and Sociology of Modernity at the Faculty of Political Science at the University of Pisa, and now is a researcher at the same university. He studied the history of the ruling classes in Tuscany and then focused his attention on the history of the University of Pisa in 19th and 20th century. Since 2008, he collaborates with CISUI, and in 2011, he was involved in the organization of the International Conference on Academic Institutions and 1968, and then he co-edited the conference proceedings. He has written also on popular education in 20th century, and on the Italian resistance. Dr. Breccia proposed us a public proposographic trajectories of the Italian 68, presenting the first results of a research focused on three case studies, Turin University, Milan University Statale, Polytechnic University, Catholic University of Sacro Cuore, University Bocconi, Pisa University, and Scuola Normale Superiore. He will demonstrate the strict relationship between the students' riot and a generation change inside the academic elite. Please, Dr. Breccia.
Thank you. The recent Italian historiography on the 1968 era has been enriched by a new stream of research that looks at university events and analyzes the reaction of academic institutions towards the students' riot. Such an approach has been validated by some studies carried out outside the Italian context and focused on the evolution of the student citizenship after 1968. The aim of these studies is to investigate not only the student movement, but also the student representatives and their individual paths. I'm talking about the research project Les citoyennetés étudiantes de 1968 à nos jours, within the Centre d'histoire sociale du XXe siècle, La cité des mémoires étudiantes, and the Centre de Recherche Historique de l'Université Paris 8. This kind of approach suggests the need for more focused attention to the participation in 1968 events by both the authorities, academic authorities, government authorities, and public security authorities, and members of the movement. In many cases, the 1968 events have been the stage for public, professional, and political training of many members of the ruling elites during the following years, both in Italy and elsewhere. In short, students, professors, academic and administrative authorities, such as prefects, high police officers, etc., often served in high-level public positions after their experience during the student unrest. The paper presents the first results, as Simona said, of a research focused on three case studies. The research is based on a thorough census of people involved in 1967-68 events. Torino, of course, Torino, Milano, and Pisa were three of the main theaters of the students' movement, with, of course, important differences starting from the size, two big cities as Milano and Torino, and one college town as Pisa. In terms of sources, institutional texts have been investigated as the main reference point for collecting information. Archives of the Ministry of Interior and Ministry of Education, National Archives, University Archives. press and memoir writings have been useful to obtain additional data and evidence on the cases under investigation. Concerning chancellors, the rettori, and faculty deans, presidi, the research took as its starting point the official annual reports of each university and the minutes of the academic senates, senati accademici. On these grounds, the research moved on to consider biographic information for each individual studied, including the scientific cultural profile, the continuation of the public career of each one, and when relevant, the political experience. The case of the mathematician Alessandro Faedo, the chancellor of the University of Pisa since 1959, seems paradigmatic. Faedo was in the midst of the 68 events, facing the student riots, not only as local chancellor, but also as president of the National Organization of the Italian Chancellors. Later, in 1972, Faedo became the president of the National Research Center, CNR, and he was then elected in parliament as senator of the major governing party, the Democrazia Cristiana, from 1976 to 1983. In Pisa, the student riots took place during a long period of stability, if we look at academic administration. During the 60s, many important faculties were not concerned by changes at administrative level. They were chaired by prominent personalities, which also held some public duties at local level. To give an example, Lucio Lazzarino, the dean of the Faculty of Engineering from 1965 to 1988, was his predecessor's protégé, the Christian Democrat Enrico Pistolesi. Pistolesi had been mayor and president of Pisa province. Pistolesi had been in turn a key figure for the fate of the engineering subject in Pisa. He had been the dean of the Faculty of Engineering during the whole post-war period from 1944 to 1965. The dean of another faculty, the Faculty of Agriculture, Ranieri Favilli, who held this position from 1963 to 1974 and then became chancellor of the University of Pisa after Faedo, was one of the major contributors of the successful elections for Democrazia Cristiana in Pisa in April 18, 1948. Before becoming chancellor, Favilli held public duties as town councillor and province councillor. Finally, the Dean of Faculty of Mathematical, Physical and Natural Sciences, Bernardo Cacciapuoti, who had belonged to the Enrico Fermi School, enjoyed great renown and a very good reputation both in the academic world and at international political and academic level. I'm quoting from the official tribute to his memory published by the university. Right after the end of the Second World War, Cacciapuoti was hired by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs to hold important and sensitive duties for our country within the United Nations and our Washington Embassy. I'm going on quoting the tribute. It then enabled Italy to enter into many convenient agreements in the field of scientific and technological cooperation. These were the words of the official tribute. The interesting public paths just mentioned for PISA seem to reveal a sort of continuity, no breaks during or after 1968 events. Elsewhere, on the contrary, the academic career of other chancellors or deans had a stop in the same period due to their disposition, relatively positive, towards dialogue and towards openness to the movement. In Milan, the dean of the big faculty of architecture, Carlo De Carli, was actually removed from his assignment by the government in 1968. Also, during these months, the powerful chancellors of Catholic University and State University in Milano, Giovanni Polvani and Ezio Franceschini, broke off their mandate. The same happened to the chancellor of the University of Torino, Mario Allara, former anti-fascist partisan, who interrupted in 1968 his very long mandate that has been lasting since the liberation of the city in 1945. In Torino, Giuseppe Grosso has been the dean of the important faculty of law since 1945. In 1968, Grosso became the mayor of Torino after a long career as town councillor in the ranks of Democrazia Cristiana. Due also to student and worker riots, Grosso resigned after a few months in 1968. Again in Torino, the dean of the Faculty of Education, Guido Quazza, who was also an ex-partisan, chose the dialogue to negotiate with the members of the student movement. His later scientific and educational works constituted an attempt at carrying out the demand for reform that emerged in 1968. Looking at the professional paths of academic authorities, chancellors and deans, it is possible to conclude that the student riots caused, at least in part, a generation change inside the academic elite. As I just tried to show, several interesting biographical paths come out by mapping all faculties' deans between 1977 and 1978 after analyzing their academic, cultural, and political profile. About teaching staff, a sample of individuals has been chosen, consisting of the main members of the representative organizations of tenured and temporary professors who took part in the events. In order to follow a common criterion to define such a sample, the specific dossier dedicated to those organizations by the Ministry of Interior have been used, together with the information offered by the press and the memoirs. In fact, besides carefully following the events involving association and student groups, the Ministry of Interior was also investigating, as a preventive measure, the trade union experiences of professors and teaching assistants. The above-mentioned activity of the Ministry of Interior has been chosen as one of the main criteria to take a chance on the students. Dossiers and reports on the movement in each city and on specific groups identify and provide information on the most involved youth in the 68 riot. Individuals that come out from these sources later played an important role in trade unions and political parties. They had high responsibility careers in the civil service or in the academic system, or in big public or private companies. To give an example, Massimo D'Alema, a student of Scuola Normale, after having joined the movement in 1968, started his political career as town councillor in Pisa. Student mobilization from Pisa were a real training also for Fabio Mussi. Mussi was a student at Scuola Normale, then Pisa town council, then after being a student at Scuola Normale, he was a Pisa town councillor and finally high-ranking leader of the Communist Party. And then he became minister. Gianmario Cazzaniga and Umberto Carpi were already graduated in 1968, and during the following years, Cazzaniga and Carpi held high-level duties in national trade unions and political parties. For instance, after being a student political leader at national level, Cazzaniga was the founder and then the national secretary of the schools division of CGL trade union, one of the leaders of the Socialist Party and then of the Communist Party. Within PC, Cazzaniga was in charge for the university policies between 1976 and 1978. All of above mentioned figures had in common their studies at the Scuola Normale of Pisa. Together with the other students, they studied at the Scuola Normale and were involved in protest, anticipating a specific cursus honorum of the Italian left, which stood very far from government positions until the 90s. How many time I have? It's okay. It could be interesting to go on reflecting about the history of the Scuola Normale, moving along the pattern laid down by the researches of Carlucci, Mariuzzo, and Moretti. Actually, the Scuola Normale was a university originally conceived to create intellectual and ruling elites, and the opposition leaders who studied there were not absolutely few. If we look at Torino, the leader of students' riot, which took place there, Guido Viale, will have worked as advisor of various public authorities, like Luigi Bobbio, who later worked as professor at the University of Torino. Vittorio Riser, already graduated in 1968, was also a professor, but at the same time held political duties within left-wing parties. Moreover, someone became a part of the national financial elite as Sergio Cusani, active member of the student movement of Bocconi University. Cusani has been a powerful manager and a top financial advisor. Finally, main government and police authorities are also mapped. Prefects, questori, the provincial chiefs of police, and police officers most involved in investigating university movement affairs. Also for these public officers, the 1968 era have presented an important moment for the continuation of their career. It's useful to mention the paradigmatic experience of Libero Mazza, the prefect of Milano, who expressly sided against the university movement until 1974. Since 1979, Mazza has been holding public duties with, again, Democrazia Cristiana. He was elected senator, then town councillor in Milano. For those who were in charge of public security and management of student protests, 1968 and later political developments of the movement represented a significant training, but also an important point of reference for reading the future events. In 1971, Prefect Libero Mazza sent to the Minister of Interior a report stating that the subversive attitude of the student mobilization was really dangerous. The student movement was the tantamount of terrorism. this was the thinking of Mazza. Towards this kind of danger, the solution for Mazza was to declare the student movement out of law. The Rapporto Mazza will have been an unavoidable paradigm for an entire generation of civil servants, along with the theory of the extremism on both sides, the opposti estremismi. It became a widespread opinion, shared and often mentioned by the protagonists of those years. Therefore, many prefects who were educated in the second half of the 60s were able to develop a renewed model of interpretation of their public action, claiming explicitly the existence of an enemy of the institution, a political opponent of institutions, the movement with its subversive potential and its will of destruction of the constitutional order. Since the end of fascism, repression and even violent behavior against the worker and peasant movements have never enjoyed such an open ideological support. Such forms of political struggle were closely connected to the Communist Party, but the Communist Party was the founder of the anti-fascist republic together with Democrazia Cristiana. It is interesting to see that the claim that the youth protests were potentially subversive was a widespread argument in senior officials' memoirs who were active during that period and even later, until recent years. Therefore, the quite numerous memoirs now available, also for the public officers, have provided interesting suggestions. Before verifying these conclusions with the memoirs, it will be important to track the transfers of the officials from one city to another, the promotion, etc. In some cases, the transfers concerned the cities where the students' movement was strong, perhaps because of the experience gained by the public officer. In order to understand the selection criteria of leaders and their transfers, some useful elements will eventually emerge. To give an example, Mariano Perris was in charge of the political office of Torin Polis in 1968, but he was also appointed chief of Pisa Police, where he dealt with violent protests between demonstrators and police. Two young people died during his mandate, but afterwards, in 1975, Mariano Perris was appointed by the minister as chief of Milan Police. In conclusion, the biographies of which I have given a brief presentation during my intervention seem to show that 1968 represented an inescapable turning point for many protagonists of Italian public life of the last 40 years, doesn't matter on which side of the barricades they were. All of them had to measure up with the events of 1968, which had directly or indirectly an indisputable value. Many high-ranking leaders of the years following 1968 in political, administrative, and academic sectors took active part in the events of 1968. If we put together all their public careers, often related to different sectors, we could see, at least in part, the portrait of one or more ruling elites. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Breccia, for this prosopographical approach to an Italian generation.